Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
It's good to see you again.
I was just looking at this flyer about the Deen Show.
Well, that's why we're here.
You walk up.
I got some more good news for you.
Tell me.
We got another good topic and we'd like to bring you back on to cover it.
All right, it sounds great. Wait a minute. What's the topic this time?
The Trinity.
The Trinity. Okay, let's go talk
about
the Trinity.
Let's go talk about the Trinity.
That's a good idea.
Handsome Yusuf cried, Allah is enough for me.
Welcome back to the Deen Show. I'm your host, Eddie. Now, you coming from a Christian background, you, your father who knew the Bible very well, he was also a minister, I'm sure you can really help give some insight to this topic, the Trinity.
When we talk about the Trinity, this is not really three gods. This is one of the things that the folks who criticize the Catholic Church, they're the ones who really came up with this idea to start with. And then subsequently, any churches that broke off from the Catholic Church, those who protested, or Protestants, they carried that forward as well. But there are those who criticize the Trinity, not realizing how this all came about. It's not fair. And then there are those who claim to be Unitarians because they say we believe in the unity of God as one. And then the Trinitarians, of course, are saying that God is one, but right away, real fast, but there are three natures to God, or there are three parts within one, or the demonstration that I gave about the finger when you can move it like that. So, how did one become three? Let's ask it like that. Because in fact, the Old Testament, the Bible, the Jewish belief and so on, even till today, is God is one. And there's no consideration for anything else. And there's not two, not three, not four. It's one.
So Abraham, did Abraham ever utter this word Trinity, or Moses, or Noah?
As far as uttering a word Trinity, the word is Latin. None of them spoke the Latin language. They wouldn't have used it anyway. And as far as that goes, the word Trinity itself is not found in any of the scriptures. Not even in the Apocrypha, you don't find this word.
How about for when one says, for there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Son...
But we said the word Trinity is not there. Okay, the word Trinity is not in the Bible, not in any scripture. That word Trinity is not there. It's not until you get to the Qur'an that you find this word.
So what is this verse that I just quoted you that people used to support to Trinity?
The verse that you're talking about now, this is in John, but it's not John the Gospel. This is the John 1, or the first epistle of John. And it's not necessarily even the same John anyway.
Yeah.
It's in chapter 5, verse 7. And it says, there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, and these three are one. This verse, as a matter of fact, is an addition. And all of the scholars of the Bible agree that this was added many, many, many centuries later by someone who wanted to resolve this issue once and for all and prove that somehow there could be three.
Let me get this straight. So this is not in the original manuscript?
Well, nobody can say it's not because they don't have the original manuscript.
So it's not in the copy of the copy of the
copy? But it's not in anything. No, it's not in anything within, I think, the first the first 1,000 years, okay? Anything in the first 1,000 years wouldn't have had that. It was added much later in the Koine Greek.
Gotcha.
Okay. Now, there were things that were in Trinity, mentioning Trinity, that were injected in some of these Latin copies and so on, but those were rejected anyway. But in the Koine Greek, there was never anything in any of the early manuscripts or anything that came after that. That was, you know, anything serious that used this word Trinity.
Yeah.
And nor was there anything with this verse in it. Okay, what it is, it's a takeoff of the verse before it and a rewording of that verse to try to add what they wanted to. It says in the verse before it that there are three that bear witness. the Father, the blood, and the Spirit, and these three agree. The Father, the blood, and the Spirit, and these three agree. And it doesn't say they're all in heaven, and it doesn't say that they are one. It says they agree. But it was a chance for somebody to say, oh, wait, look, here's three things. Now we'll try to wrap it up and turn it into something. There were some very serious fights, and we're not talking about just fights with words. We're talking about the kind of fights where people were being poisoned, people being killed over this subject. That's how really horrible it got by the 3rd century. There was something called Arianism versus the Council of Nicaea. This is, I'm referring to something I have on a website about this. And Arius is the one who was insisting that the nature of Jesus was such that he's not divine and he's not a part of God. But they were always arguing over how you explain the nature of Jesus. Is he created or is he born? Is he begotten or is he not begotten? And the wording on how you would say that would determine whether or not you were considered to be a kafir, a disbeliever. And so that's how this kicks off. And then the Nicaea Council offers a resolution on that. Basically, if you don't agree with this, we'll kill you. It was almost that bad.
Was this over the rule of Constantine?
Constantine was the one basically who was presiding over the council himself. And yet he was a pagan sun god worshiper. He was in the cult called Saul Invictus. Saul is sun in Latin. Invictus means invincible. They believed that the sun was invincible, and they believed that the sun had a sun on earth, which was basically the representative of the sun power, etc. And he considered himself to be that one. And only 5 years before this council, he had actually engaged in a war against some of the people who believed in Jupiter as being the god. You know the planet Jupiter?
Yes.
And the guy who was the son of Jupiter was killed by him in that war. So he considered himself the big warrior. But to come back to this Trinity business, when Constantine convened this council, what he was looking for is absolution. He wanted to be rid of his guilt and sin for having drowned his, or actually boiling his wife and boiled his son because of the fear that they would try to compete with him for his position.
Talk about emperor. Insecurity, huh?
Well, in any case, he found a way to get it done. It was through this one sect of Christianity said that if he would say that Jesus was the Son of God and died for his sins, then they would forgive him of his sins.
Yeah, interesting.
And then the trade-off was then that the Roman government would now be forced to accept this particular sect of Christianity as the royal or the official church of the realm. And with that, this gave these bishops a good position. Because prior to that time, the Roman government was killing people who were Christians and using them for entertainment. Take them out, throw them into the gladiators, throw them out to the lions and bears, things like that. It was horrible. It was disgraceful. And it was, of course, they were killing people. So
check this out.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. And welcome to the mailbag on the Deen Show, where we answer the questions of our viewers and our listeners about Islam and hopefully clear up some of the misconceptions that many of us may have about the reality of Islam. Let's look and see what we have today. Okay, this writer asked, why don't you Muslims accept that God can be a Trinity? Well, thank you for that very good question. We can't possibly accept that God could be a Trinity because it's not necessary. Because in order for God to be a Trinity, that means that he would have to require help. And in order for him to require help, that means he would be dependent upon another God, which obviously doesn't exist, or he would be dependent upon something that he had himself had created. And so it's an obvious contradiction, dear listener, that to even expect or think or even hope that God would have to be a Trinity is a contradiction to the actual existence of Almighty God, because in order for there to be a Trinity, then he would have to require the assistance, as we said, of something else that he has created. That means that he, in order for there to be a Trinity, he would have to create another son that he would need assistance from. He would have to create a ghost that he would need assistance from. So there can't be a Trinity. There's not three gods. That means that one of the gods had to come first if there was three gods. And God himself is only one, and he doesn't require any help from anyone. That would take away, and it's an insult and contradictory to the existence and the fact that God is one and God is the Almighty. How can we dare say that God is Almighty and we call him Almighty God, and then still on the other side of the coin, say again that God is a Trinity, that he has to be three in one? Why would he have to be three in one? Why would God, who is not created, who is the beginning, who is the end, who is the Alpha and Omega, this one supreme God who brought about the entire creation? In Christianity, we were taught that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh, and the flesh dwelt among us. But we weren't taught what that Word was. In Islam, we're taught what the Word was, the Word that was the beginning. The Word that brought about the beginning of creation was Kun, which means be. And the Quran says, Kun fayakun, be and it is. So this is how God brought about creation. But it's not how God brought about himself, because God did not have to bring about himself. God was not created, nor was he even self-created. God himself is the beginning, and you can't think past God. So in order to think that God needs two other beings to help him to rule the universe, then that means that there would have to be something that came before God or came along with God, or that God himself had created. But God himself has no need for a Trinity, and God does not do unnecessary things. The creator of the heavens and the earth is complete, without form, without description, and he has no limitations. He has no height, no weight, no depth, no width. He has nothing that can be described by human beings, and therefore there's no need for Almighty God to be a Trinity, and it's impossible to expect that God would even have to be a Trinity, because in order for him to be a Trinity, then he would have to be reliant upon something that he has created, because no one else has the ability to create anything. Things can only be done by the help and the will and the plan of Almighty God. That's why we cannot believe, nor can we possibly expect, even with our wildest imagination, that God could be a Trinity, because it's contradictory to the very existence of Almighty God. We hope we answered your question. That's it for this session of the Mailbag on the Deen Show. Tune in next time. Thank you.
They were killing people.
So up until then, if I get this straight, correct me if I'm wrong, I don't want to put words in your mouth, that we had a stream of true monotheism coming from one direction.
Of course.
You had another stream coming from another direction, and it seems that this direction of the Trinity came over and Romanized Christianity with all their traditions that were going on.
No, I don't think so. I don't think that's what we're saying here. Is that the more you study this, I don't think you'll see that Christianity became influenced by that. I think this was just Rome's church adapting a few things from them, that's all. Because at the council, here's the things that they did. I'm looking at their website right now, on our website. I have a copy of it.
Yeah, where can someone find this?
You can go to our main website for this is 911
Bible. 911
Bible. Yeah, you can find a lot of information over there. Another one we have is called the Islam Code, ISLAMCODE.com, and we talk about the Trinity there as well. But in any case, even on their own website, they explain that what happened when the Council of Nicaea took place, the Roman government itself is now accepting Christianity as the official religion, that particular sect. So this is good news for the Christians in a way, but now there was compromises. One of the compromises was they had to change the date of the birthday of Jesus to become the 25th of December, which coincided with the birth of a god called Mithras.
Interesting.
Another thing they had to do is to implement another feast or festival called the Feast of Ishtar. And this is the goddess of fertility. This is why they have the reference here now to the eggs, yeah, and to the rabbits, because they multiply quickly. So it was a fertility festival from the goddess Ishtar, which we today call Easter. That's where your Easter eggs, your bunnies, and all the rest of it are coming from. This has nothing to do whatsoever with Christianity. Now, most of the Christians know this. Most of the knowledgeable Christians, they know this. And certainly the scholars in Christianity will acknowledge that immediately. This is something that is no part of Christianity. Now, another thing that took place was to decide which books of the Bible would be now canonized. And that's where this expression comes from at that time. That's when the Catholic Church said, this is what the Bible will be. And that's it, finish. Don't argue about it anymore. Because they used to argue about which books, put some in, take some out. But even the Catholic Church, over a period of time, took out the book of Revelations and then put it back in. And then took it out and put it back in. This is not our subject today, but I'm just letting you know that many things took place at that council.
Yes.
It wasn't just that they said this in this reference to the Trinity. Because when they accepted it, of course it's going to make a problem, because how will you resolve this when it's clear through the Bible that God is one? How you resolve it? Well, the influence here is coming from the government, not from the scholars so much, but the ones who were in the leadership position of the church wanted to do their best to twist things, bend things, compromise, so they could get this position. Let's don't go back to being thrown out into the lions, you know, guys. Let's work with these people and we become number one. You know, you're number one in the best condition as a church, you know, and can spread our thing through the world. But we're going to compromise. Otherwise, we're back out here being eaten by lions, and what's the benefit of that? So I think that was the mindset. I'm trying to give you an idea based on what information we have available today, but I think that seems logical. Another point is that the word Catholic means universal. It was always the universal church of Rome. It never was a Christian church. And it was in business long, long, long before they were affiliated with Christians. Because Rome had a church, and when citizens wanted to join, or if they took over a country and you would like to be a full citizen, you had to join this church. Now, you could keep your old gods, no problem, but you definitely needed to be a part of this. So that is still the name of it today, Roman Catholic Church, Universal Church of Rome.
Now, if I'm reading what was available to me at that time, and I'm finding I'm sincere and I want to pray to God alone, how did I fit in this equation when everybody's trying to support this other belief, this other theology?
Eddie, you can't say it that way, because people didn't have Bibles. It wasn't until the time of Gutenberg, when he produced that press and started running Bibles off, that a common person could even have access. And also, it was illegal, even up until 1511, it was forbidden for anyone to translate the Bible to the English language, even up to the time of 1511, when William Tyndale produced his whole entire Bible in English. And what they did, they executed him. They burned him. The church burned him at the stake with his Bible tied to his chest.
Why?
Because it's illegal. It's blasphemy to translate the Bible. Nobody was to have it. The priest only, and in the Latin language. That's how the law was. And it was 100 years after that, even after William Coverdale, a student of Tyndale's, came with another one. In 1611, there was a group who actually translated the Bible to English again. That's what we call King James Version. But in fact, King James didn't even know they did it till after the fact. They wrote a soliloquy in the beginning of it, praising him, worshiping him, calling him Lord, even, hoping that he would accept and not kill them. He never authorized it, although he never killed them either. But he never officially authorized it. So they nicknamed it the Authorized Version. When it came to our country, it was called the King James Version. Get it? That's how that works. So to come back to the Trinity, though, nobody at the time of the Catholic Church taking over at 325, nobody could have sat around and read the Bible anyway. How are you going to read something that doesn't exist? What they had was some priests who had some manuscripts or pieces of manuscripts, copies of things that were even in the Koine Greek and so on, but they did not have any full, complete Bible. That did not exist at that time.
So tell us, how at the end did this word come about?
Well, you know, when I say, by the way, that they didn't have a Bible, what I'm talking about is that the average person didn't, because they did have the Roman Vulgate that was done by Jerome. And it has a tremendous amount of mistakes in it and so on, but that's beside the point. This word Trinity comes about as a result of the influence of the Roman government itself. The Roman government was considered a triune government because it had three bodies, just like the United States has three bodies. You have your president, you have the Senate, you have the Congress there, you know, and this all together is equaling three. This is taken right from the Roman government. The Roman government also had three, and there three to make up their one body. And they were all in unison on their decisions. You follow? So when the Roman government takes over, they want to have this to remain in the church, which they had had before. So this was why there was an emphasis and a real push to make sure it stayed. But the real problem in the early days wasn't over so much as whether God was one, two, or three. The real problem was over the issue of what was the nature of Jesus. Was he God? Was he man? Was he man-God or God-man? Was he born? Was he created? Was he always? And they would get into that, because if you didn't say he was always, you were a blasphemer. According to some, of course. And then another thing comes up, a passage in the Bible talking about the Spirit. That the blasphemy is that you say anything against the Spirit. The Spirit is essentially a part of the deity or something at that stage. So this becomes an issue that gets so big and so distorted, and over the years, people just say, look, just believe it, just have faith, let it go. God is one, but, you know, he has these three parts, or he's like three things at one time. And, you know, like for instance, I can be a father, and I can be a brother, I can be a son, all at the same time. True? Of course, I could be father, brother, son, grandfather, uncle, cousin. So it wouldn't be limited. And I really think that when people start using these kinds of examples, and especially trying to compare God to a human or anything else that he created, I think they're way off track. The best thing is to consider what Allah told us in the Qur'an. Allah told us, and he told us about Trinity in the Qur'an. That's why I said, it's not in the Bible, but it's in the Qur'an. Tell the Christians not to say three. It was clearly what Allah says to us, because God is one. There's only one God, and he doesn't have any partners. Finish. La ilaha illallah, la sharika la.
That's very simply put. So we know that this wasn't a teaching of Jesus. It wasn't a teaching of Abraham.
No.
It wasn't a teaching of any of the prophets.
No.
And not even the teaching of the last and final messenger to mankind, the Prophet Muhammad.
Well,
from the scripture that we do have, we don't find any of it in there.
You have a lot of criticism of Paul. A lot of people criticize Paul. And when you go to seminary school, you'll find that there are three synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Then you have the Johann gospel. Then you have a teaching and dogma that's coming, and you don't have it all. It's not the same. It's not the same message. It's not the same teaching. And one of the key things they talk about is Pauline doctrine. Because Pauline doctrine isn't the same. It doesn't follow the same way at all. And it has a different message even to the extent of breaking all the commandments and just, you know, being dead to the law. And if the falsehoods I tell bring the people closer to God, then why are they persecuting me? This is coming from Paul. And his ideas of, and they were strange ideas. Some claim that his ideas were based on the mystical religion of Tarsus, where he was raised up. But regardless of that, and no matter how far you stretch it out, you cannot find Paul using this word Trinity.
He didn't even.
Even he didn't come up with this idea. He didn't come up with that kind of a nature of God or Jesus, either one.
What's the alternative now for the people who agree with you and they've done a little research, or you know what, to them it also doesn't make sense? What's the alternative that they don't lose faith, which is another alternative and wait for them to go?
I don't want anybody to lose their faith. I don't. There are Trinitarians and Unitarians, Christians, Jews, Muslims out there talking about this subject. I don't want anybody to give up, though. Don't give up. This is my advice to myself as well. When I'm confused about anything, if I get upset about anything, then I need to go back to the Lord above and open up my own communication with Him and pray to Him and ask Him to guide me to the answer. Because quite frankly, human beings are to each other just other human beings. We can't be gods to each other. We would like to help each other out and help to gain a better knowledge, better understanding. But for sure, it's only the Lord above who's going to grant this real wisdom, this real insight and understanding. And you have to be patient. And you have to take your time. And then when you get an idea, and the Lord puts something in your mind, speaks to your heart, then you need to go and read what it is He wants you to read or think about it. Go sit with the people that He's guiding you to. You might be surprised. You might find yourself sitting with Muslims talking to them about it, or you might find yourself talking to Jewish talking about the subject, or a Hindu. I'm not telling you not to do something. I'm telling you just to think about what you're doing. This is what I'm saying. And pray to your Lord and really ask Him to come into your life in a way that He can guide you. Because most of us, we're fighting guidance all the time.
Thank you again for being with us, Shay.
It's great to be with you.
We're going to have you back on again.
Oh, we'll see.
God willing. Well, there you have it. From our guest, former Christian preacher, minister, Sheikh Yusuf Estes. I'd like to thank everybody who's been tuning in from day one to the Deen Show. If you don't catch us live, don't worry. All the shows that we've taped, you can catch it on the deenshow.com website. And if you get stuck anywhere over here on any of these topics, 911 Bible, we have a lot of the information there also. And just to recap, God is one. Just like if you take your family of three to the airport with one ticket, it's only going to be for one person. You cannot split it up into three. God's not like a pie that you split him up. He's one, absolutely one, and one alone. This is the same message of Jesus, Abraham, Moses, Noah, and all the prophets of Almighty God. So, we ask you again to worship God alone and not to associate any partners with Him. And this is the main message of Islam. So we look forward to seeing you again here on the Deen Show. If you have any comments or suggestions, please email me. And this is your host, Eddie, signing off. Assalamu alaikum. Peace be unto you.